Hello, Rebecca here. I just got back from a run. It's beautiful out. It's almost spring, and I'm feeling inspired to talk about feet. I know I've promised to talk about feet before, and it's very daunting because I have so much to say about feet, but I'll try and keep this a relatively short video. I'm in kinesiology. I work at the running room, but I'm not your doctor. I've never seen your feet, probably, if you're watching this video. So just remember that there are lots of resources you can use to find out more about your feet specifically, and I'm not prescribing anything, just giving you some ideas. So the first thing I want to talk about is I'm going to teach you to practice making an arch in this video, and basically why would someone do this and why do we not have arches? So I have what some people would call flat feet. Now this is a really, really bad term because my feet aren't flat. They have a nice arch when I'm not weight bearing, but then as soon as I put my weight on them, they flatten right out. So I've got what you would call a cavus foot, a high arch, but it's hypermobile, so it's very flexible. Now how did my feet get this way? A lot of people in my generation started wearing running shoes from a really young age. The natural foot, the anatomical foot, is kind of shaped like a piece of pizza or like a triangle. So your heel is the narrowest part, and then your big toe and baby toe are the widest parts. And kids should run around barefoot and strengthen those foot muscles, especially during the time in their life when their weight starts to increase by big increments, like during puberty. If you're wearing shoes that have stability features in them, a lot of cushioning, a pointed toe box, toe spring or toe rocker in the shoe, during this time of your life, your foot muscles will kind of just be handicapped. And I know there's a lot of people who have read Born to Run and are trying to learn to run barefoot. And all the more power to you, just remember that you have to start really, really slow with that because your little foot muscles, if they didn't develop during that point in your life, I think you might have a lot of trouble learning to run barefoot. Now, I'm going to just go over some of the features in a shoe that you might, if you have my type of foot, get sold at a place that fits shoes properly, for example at the running room. So first I guess it'll be helpful to show you my feet. You can probably see them. Here they are. Wiggly things that they are, absolutely no problem completely flattening down those arches. So this is the shoe that I just ran in. It is a mild to moderate stability shoe. It's the Saucony Guide 6, I think I've got here. Yeah, the Guide 6. And some of the stability features in a shoe, well, first of all, most running shoes, unless they are barefoot shoes, will have a heel-to-toe rocker and some toe spring. So this is a heel-to-toe offset, not rocker. So these are an 8mm heel-to-toe offset. You can find shoes on the market these days everywhere from 12mm down to zero. The idea with zero is that the shoe's not propelling you. You have to do the work yourself. Transitioning to that sort of thing is not something that everyone has to do, but I digress. Back to these shoes. The first thing that they'll do for a shoe like this to try and make it more stable for someone whose arches tend to roll inward is to put a kind of a varus angle in the back of the shoe. So the idea is that by making it softer on the outside, instead of having that collapsing inward like that, you'll be landing more like this. And you can see I've drawn a little line there on my heel bone, my calcaneus. So if the shoe is flat, then I'm gonna land like this because of my hypermobile foot. If they put that angle in theory, it'll counteract that and make me land more normal. Now, the idea with that is that when I strike, if I'm striking on my heel, everything stays in line from the calcaneus, the heel bone, up through the tibia, and hopefully keeps me in good alignment. The second thing for my flexible foot that they would put in this shoe is stability or a high-density foam on the arch. So the idea with this is that makes the shoe a lot more torsionally stiff. They also have a little plastic bridge there on the bottom. And so the shoe won't flex with my foot. It'll counteract that movement. This is called motion control also, and it is not arch support. So these features of shoe are there to stabilize the movement of your foot, but they are not an arch support. Now, because I have such flimsy feet, I actually do wear an arch support. So some shoes may feel like they come up and hug your arch, and that's a really good thing in a shoe, but some people might need a little extra help. I've got a custom orthotic here. I've got an off-the-shelf insole. This one's a little beat up, but you can see how it still has a nice arch in there. And I've got my beautiful flip-flops, which are made by the same company, Sole, and they have an arch support in there as well, as a metatarsal button, which these orthotics don't. So, if you see from the back, again, we've got that line drawn on my heel, kind of angled inward there, put it onto something with an arch and a heel cup, a little straighter. Usually it's better to have a shoe so that there's something for the orthotic to act against. Well, that one feels a little better even. And then my flip-flop here. Not bad. Now, all of them feel better than just my bare feet because, quite frankly, I have lazy feet. So, the first thing to practice making an arch is to look at those points of your foot that are to bear the most weight and to stabilize you. So your foot, as I said, slice of pizza shaped. Now I know that my toes are kind of pointed inward, they're deviated inward because of the toe boxes that I wore growing up and other abuse that I put my feet through, like ski boots and rock climbing shoes. But those two points are not the ones that you want to work on really. So the points here and here, those ball of your foot bone heads are your metatarsal heads. So these are the long bones in your foot. And those two points that I just showed are the ones that we're going to want to try and get to bear the weight. So the first thing that I like to do when teaching someone to make an arch, stand normally with your feet about a hip width apart. It's actually easier if you try to learn raising your toes. Raising your toes naturally makes that arch and draws your heel back into line. What you can do from here, once you've kind of got that arch feeling, is reset your heels, because your fat pads, if you start standing like this and then you go like that, your fat pad is kind of being pushed outward, that big fat pad under your heel. So start like that, lift those toes, create an arch, and then reset it so that you're kind of balanced on your fat pad. And then once we've got this nice arch in here and we feel like the weight is evenly distributed in your first and your fifth metatarsal heads, then we practice putting the big toe down and then all the others. I'm trying to maintain that nice strong arch. Imagine your foot's a tripod where these two points in your heel are just taking all the weight. Now this is hard for me. It actually makes my feet cramp. So I need to practice this a lot more. So this is the most valuable for me when I'm doing dishes and I'm kind of standing mindlessly at the sink. I do wear my flip-flops or my arch supports in the house often, but it's also good for me to try to go barefoot and try to remind myself to do it as much as possible. If you get a bit tired doing that, you could actually try, for example, doing reps by lifting and lowering your toes and trying to do it while you're not looking. I feel quite a lot of pressure in those medial arch muscles in my foot there trying to do that. So this is basically a way to teach yourself. If you're in a position like me where your foot's just kind of not so good at maintaining its stability on its own, it's a way to have good posture from the ground up. Everything starts with your feet. If you're standing on lazy feet all day, you can be pretty sure something else is going to be out of alignment or that you'll have foot pain in the long term. Now, the last thing I'd like to mention is a good idea for getting your feet to wake up and use your foot muscles. It's probably going to look a little weird on camera, so bear with me, but I hope that everyone's inspired to try this. So, I have my moisturizer here. How do we moisturize our hands? We put it on and we rub it and we get it all through our fingers. I think that people should try to do this with their feet as well. So rather than using your hands to apply moisturizer on your feet, I think you should just put it on your feet and try to interlace those toes and moisturize your feet with your feet. This is good for waking up your sensory receptors in your feet, learning to use those toe muscles. It probably looks a little weird, as I said, but hey, you don't have to touch your feet all the time then if you do this. So that's my good idea for waking up your feet, moisturizing your feet, and also my little tutorial on how to make an arch. So I hope this is helpful. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments below. And happy standing!